أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with the most perfect book, the Quran, a book of guidance for all of mankind, not just for Muslims. It is a book which Allah Himself states within it, is a book which encompasses previous books, their principles, and also reaffirms what He has given to previous prophets, reaffirms the scriptures and the books revealed to them. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in a verse, and He says that this book, the Quran, is a guide for all of mankind. It is instructions from your Lord, and it's a healing for what is in the hearts, as well as being a guidance and mercy for believers. Contemplating on the verses of the Quran is something which is incumbent upon you and I. Simply reading it has a value to it, but contemplating on its verses, understanding its lessons, is where you and I will begin to understand its gems. Reciting it in a beautiful voice is on the basic level, but then understanding what we're saying and understanding the conversation from Allah to us as His servants is where you and I will begin to be able to practice and not simply be like that donkey that's mentioned in Surah Jum'ah, an animal which keeps its books on its back but takes no benefit from it. Simply reading the Quran is beneficial, but the real benefit will come when we begin to implement its instructions, because it heals what is inside our hearts. There are some vices which are within us which we're not aware of. There are some problems that we may have within our hearts, in these unclean and impure hearts, that we may not be able to even eradicate. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, reciting this Quran, pondering on its verses, acting in accordance with it, will be a shifa, will be a healing for what is in the hearts, and a mercy for all of mankind. There is no better time to become acquainted with this holy book than the month in which it was revealed. This holy month of Ramadan is an opportunity for you and I not only to recite the Quran, but also to become acquainted with it. By not eating, by not sleeping too much, by not performing other actions, in this holy month you and I are able to gain extra time. We have a choice. We can use this extra time to our benefit in getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or we can waste this time by simply relaxing and doing actions which will be of benefit to us in this world or the next. Whenever we do an action, the first thing we should ask ourselves is, how will it benefit us in the next life? There are many actions which will benefit us in this life, but an action that is of true value for us to be doing it and use our time in it is an action which will give us benefit fit dunya and in the akhirah, in this world and the next, or simply in the next. But an action which will only give us benefit in this world is an action whose fruits will only be seen in this world, and when we finally close our eyes, we shall begin to be answerable for every moment that we wasted. One of the greatest things we can do, once again, I emphasize, is to acquaint ourselves with this holy book, the Quran, memorizing its verses, understanding it, reading its translation. Sometimes we feel that the Quran is in Arabic. If I read it, it gives me thawab. But you're not only after thawab. We're after change, we're after action. Sometimes it doesn't need us to read it in Arabic. There are times we can read it in Arabic, but also read the translation as well if we don't understand this God-given language and this God-chosen language of Arabic. Continuing in today's recording of Surah Yusuf, we have arrived at that stage in the surah when we understand that two vices are made very clear in this chapter. Two vices which are harbored within the brothers, vices of pride and jealousy. And we saw in the last episode that these vices can take man to such a stage that they become worse than animals. They're willing to kill simply because one has been gifted and the other hasn't. The brothers of Yusuf go a step forward and they even pass judgment on their father. They say that surely our father is in great error. He's making an error in judgment. Why? Because we're a strong brotherhood. We're from a different mother. We're strong in ourselves. We're grown men. We're the ones who bring in the money. We're the ones who go to work. Yusuf and his brother are from a different wife. They're from a different mother. And our father is paying so much attention to them. Where is our attention? The only way we'll be able to gain this attention is by removing Yusuf and possibly his brother from the picture. But look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows you and I that one who has jealousy and acts upon his jealousy, as the ahadith tell us, will only bring about misery in the dunya and the akhirah. When they did what they did and they took Yusuf to the well and they tried to remove him from the picture, were they able to gain the love of their father? Were they able to gain the attention of their father? Quite the opposite. Their father became more infatuated with Yusuf. Their father longed for Yusuf because of the separation until his eyes turned blind. Such was the love that he had for Yusuf. Today's episode, I'd like to discuss upbringing. Because in this verse in particular, two questions arise. The first is did Ya'qub do something wrong in his upbringing? Is it right that a parent should love one child more than the other? Or show that he loves one child more than the other? Is this justice? Is this equality? Is this how we're meant to bring up our children? Or is it possible that these brothers of Yusuf were lying? Is it possible that Ya'qub was showing the correct amount of love to each child, but these brothers had misconstrued it, misunderstood it, and they felt that Ya'qub was favoring one over the other? In order to answer the question very simply, we must first realize who these brothers were. What type of individuals were they, at least at the beginning of this chapter? They were individuals who were willing to kill a 7-year-old, to kill a 9-year-old in Yusuf, willing to banish him, remove him from the lands, removing to the extent that they didn't want to see him again. They were willing to kill their own blood brother. Why? Because they wanted something from their father. These are not people who can be trusted in their speech. If they speak, and as we'll see later on, they even lie to their father and their father catches them out. These individuals are not individuals whose speech we can accept as truthful. So when they say that our father loves Yusuf and his brother more, when they say that our father pays more attention to Yusuf and his brother, it's not something we can accept from their speech. So now we look at how Ya'qub is treating Yusuf and his brother, Binyamin. Is it possible that a father spends more time or a parent spends more time with a child and it's acceptable? That a parent shows outwardly more love to one child or a couple of children more than other children? In order to answer this question, we must remember the hadith of Amir al-Mu'mineen in which he defines justice in a most eloquent fashion, which I don't believe has been defined anywhere else by anybody else. In order to answer this question, we should go to the hadith of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam Ali alayhi salam, in which he defines justice in a manner in which I don't think has been defined anywhere else or by anyone else. Imam says justice is to place everything in its correct place. If you have two children, one of them excels in sports and the other excels in science, is it just of you to put both of them in a private school which excels in science? Or is it just of you to put both of them in another college which is a sports college and excels in sports? You will agree that it's unjust to do both of these things. Because in the first instance, it's unjust on the child who excels in sports, and in the second instance, unjust on the child who excels in science. That means that outwardly, we do not have to do the same thing to two people in order to be just. Rather, we have to look at that individual, look at their potential, look at their capability, and then give them what they require in order to flourish in this life. For the child who excels in science, you may pay private tuition fees and send him or her to a school, to a college, to a university, which will allow them to excel in science. For the child who excels in sports, you'll put them in a sports college. That's called justice, to put things in their right place. What you and I as parents must realize is that reality and perception are two very different things. What we do in reality and how it's perceived by others can be very different. But so long as you are aware that you are treating your children in a manner which is most beneficial for that child to prosper in this world, then know that what you're doing is just. Yaqub, yes, may have spent more time with Yusuf. Yaqub may have protected Yusuf and his brothers more than he protected the other. They were young. They were the youngest of children that Yaqub had. They were from a different mother. Maybe that mother wasn't even alive anymore, so that he was acting as two parents for them. But he also knew that Yusuf was to become a prophet, or Yusuf was a prophet and was to excel and to be given isma later on, and hukman wa ilma, clear judgment and knowledge at a later stage. So he had to protect him in a manner such that he was not going to be taken away from him, so that he could ensure that he gave him the path required for him to prosper and become this great prophet. It was this reality that Yaqub was enacting that was misconstrued and misconceived by the brothers as being unjust, as the father loving Yusuf and his brother Binyamin more than he loved themselves. Imam Ali alayhi salam, when he wanted children, gives us a beautiful piece of advice. He says when he wanted children, you know, many a times when individuals want children, they pray to Allah that give me a child who will look beautiful, give me a child who will excel in their studies, who will be clever. Amirul Mu'mineen says this is not what you should desire in your children. That's something that is given then by God. Every child is beautiful to their parent. Every child is handsome and beautiful to their parents. No parent will say that my child is ugly. They might find other children not pleasing to their eyes, but their own children will be the coolness of their eyes. Amir al-Mu'mineen says that when he wanted children, he didn't ask Allah for a child who will have a beautiful face or will have a good stature. Instead, Imam says that I asked Allah for a child who will be muti'an, who will be obedient to his Lord and fearful of him, so that when a time comes that I shall see my child in the obedience of his master of Allah, I shall have coolness in my eyes. I will know that I have done my duty. I have fulfilled my duty in upbringing a child who is now fearful of his Lord, of the punishment, desirous of his Lord, understanding the mercy of his Lord, such that he wishes to obey this great master of his. These are the type of children that we should try and bring up. When we want to bring up these children, sometimes we may need to spend time, more time with one child than another. This is not being unjust. We may need to give one child more than we give another child. This is not being unjust. What is an injustice is when we give a child that which they do not require, or we do not give a child that which they require. So they're not able to fulfill their potential. Within this story, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for those who ask, there are many a sign in simply this relationship and understanding between the brothers of Yusuf and Yusuf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in chapter 12, verse number 7, in Surah Yusuf, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي يُوسُفَ وَإِخْوَتِهِ آيَاتٌ لِلسَّائِلِينَ. There are many a sign for people who ask with this relationship of Yusuf and his brother. Not simply pride and jealousy that we've touched upon. Not simply the upbringing that they've had. Not simply the misunderstanding that they have within their heads, this misconception that they have that our father loves one more than the other. There are many a sign, but you and I will only be able to extrapolate these signs and understand them if we spend time with the Quran and if we ponder on its verses. We're in this holy month of Ramadan. We have time on our hands, especially if we're living in the West. We stay up till the time of Suhoor. We don't want to sleep, we'll miss Suhoor. So we stay awake because the time is very close after we break our fast. What we should do is ensure that we use this time in the most beneficial manner. If it's seeking istighfar from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if it's praying to Him through the most immaculate, perfect prayers that we have in Sahifa, for example, if it's opening our hearts and just speaking to our Creator one-on-one in an intimate conversation in Munajat, or if it's opening up His glorious book and listening to His conversation and deliberating on these verses. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us individuals who become acquainted with the Quran, friends with the Quran, such that on the day of judgment, when we enter heaven, Allah will tell us, Iqra warqa, that read the verse of the Quran, and with every verse that you read, you shall elevate to a new station in the most glorious paradise that Allah has created for us. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammad وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين.